really nice scenery up here, isn't it?
It is beautiful. But it brings to mind here as we look at this, we have a lot of slanting of these layers. What's going on?
There? So as you look off in the distance, you can see the red rocks and the lighter tan colored rocks back there. You can see they're sitting in an angle. And as those mountains rose up, it made the flat lying layers bend a bit.
So it's kind of like we have all of these layers laid down by the flood, but then something, almost like a long bubble, has lifted them up.
Yeah, so these layers used to be flat lying. They're deposited in a marine setting. And these are the same rock layers that you would have seen down at the Vermilion Cliffs at the eastern end of Grand Canyon in Arizona. So here we are all the way up in northern Utah, and we're still seeing the same layers. But these layers would have had to be flat over this whole area, all the way down to Arizona and all the way up extending into Wyoming. And then as that, if you want to think about it as a bubble kind of rising up here, that's when those layers became slanted.
So we have the layers here on our right. Do those layers then continue and go underneath?
They do.
The red layer?
So this this layer right down here with the flat slope, I believe that's the Coconino sandstone equivalent.
We saw that in the canyon.
That we see in the canyon. And those go right underneath the red layers that we see out here. So there's a whole thick package of rocks that have been kind of churned up on edge right in here.
What has removed all of that layer?
So as you get mountain building processes, as things lift up, there's earthquake activity. These layers aren't going to be particularly hard or lithified when they're lifted up. And I think they're going to be prone to some giant landslides. They're going to be prone to a lot of erosion by just heavy rains and stuff like that that happen after the flood.
So let's go back to that situation right after the flood. We have all of those layers laid down. And then obviously there are a lot of forces at work here. Mm-hmm. Walk us through that.
So we think the best model to explain the movements during the flood is catastrophic plate tectonics. And those processes would have happened fairly quickly during the flood. And those processes happened down inside the mantle of the Earth, which is far down below us. But as the convection started in the mantle of the Earth, it actually pulled the continents down. And as it pulled the continents down, that allowed the water to flow over top of the continents, making many of these layers that we see off in the distance. But then at the end of the flood, those processes that pulled the continents down in began to slow down and stop. And so all around the world at about the same time, we see the mountains begin to rise. And that's when the Uinta Mountains rose here. That's when the front range of the Rocky Mountains would have risen. You've seen the big fold in Carbon Canyon.
Yes.
That Andrew's been studying. The same event that caused the Uinta Mountains to rise would have made the Colorado Plateau rise and made those big folds in the Tapete Sandstone.
What is the physics or the pressures and forces, though, that cause such a massive amount of material to rise?
Don't picture it as something pushing from down underneath. If you had like a piece of wood or a life jacket and you would hold that down under the water, or something could pull it down in the water and then all of a sudden that force was released, it would automatically just float right back up to the surface because it has lower density. Geologists often talk about things rising and sinking as a result of isostasy. It's a process that allows lighter things to rise and heavier things to sink. And so these rising mountains were lightweight, and that caused them or allowed them to rise back up.
I don't think many of us would look at this and think it's lightweight, but you're talking about in comparison to the density of the rock below.
In comparison with the mantle rock that would have surrounded these continents and these mountains, these continental materials that have risen back up are fairly lightweight.
So during the flood, as these are being lowered, we end up then with some sort of a tension, I guess you might say.
Yeah.
And once those processes slow down, then what was pulling them down is no longer
That's right.
Active.
That's right. So that tension is released, and as soon as it's released, it's like cutting a rope or a string on a helium balloon. It just is going to pop right back up to the surface.
So there were a lot of forces then at play at the end of the flood. Right. What other forces?
Yeah, so as these mountains rise up, you're going to have landslides that come off of them. You're going to have massive erosion events from rainfall and glaciers in places that can cause erosion. But as these mountains rise up, they make basins. So as we look off to the north, we're looking out toward the Green River Basin. And so as these mountains rose up, it kind of made a high spot that water couldn't run through initially. And we had a big lake that formed out there.
What other activities, geological activities, are happening here at the end of the flood?
So we're going to have a lot of earthquake activity as the mountains rise up. That's going to cause earthquakes and shaking, and that's going to shake loose some of these sediments,
causing some more landslides.
That's right. In other places, we're going to have volcanic activity, especially up in Yellowstone area, which is not too far north of us here. Just massive volcanic activity after the flood, but Yellowstone is just one place on the earth where we had all this volcanic activity following the flood. There's dozens of other places where we have mountain building and volcanic activity that's happening at the same time. And all of this is happening approximately the beginning of the Cenozoic period around the earth. And so we have this massive amount of mountain building, volcanic activity, and so forth as the flood begins to end and as these continents are bobbing back up to the surface.
Now, wait a second. You mentioned the Cenozoic. What is that? Where does it fit into all
this?
Well,
geologists look at the history of the Earth in about four different layers or four different times, if you will. And it doesn't matter if you're a creationist or a old Earth geologist, we all recognize about the same four periods of time. We think they had different lengths of time. The two views differ from each other, but the one that's deepest is the Precambrian, and we'll actually see those in the core of the Uinta Mountains. And then on top of the Precambrian, we have the Paleozoic. Here's some of the Paleozoic rocks, and we think these would have formed earliest in the flood. And then over here, beginning with these red rocks, that's the beginning of the Mesozoic. It means middle life. So we have Paleozoic, old life, Mesozoic, middle life. And then the most recent period is the Cenozoic, which means new life. And as a creation geologist, I think these Paleozoic and Mesozoic rocks would have formed during the flood year. So we have about a year's worth of time to form all that rock. And much of that we can see right in here. But then after the flood, in the rocks, we see brand new types of fossils like mammals and brand new types of plants. We see lots of angiosperms, for example, that show up in the rock record. And there's a lot of good reasons why we picture the Cenozoic as the end of the flood. And along with that, we see all these mountains rising up in the earliest part of the Cenozoic. And so, you know, you have mountains rising up, and, you know, what's the definition of the flood in Scripture? That it covered the mountains,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
If you have mountains rising back up and not getting eroded down by floodwaters, that's a hint geologically that the flood's over.
So the floodwaters have receded from the earth, but all of these layers, of course, are still wet,
right,
and soaked.
Yeah.
But that is when these processes are starting to lift those,
right,
layers.
Mountains rising up make the landscape fairly unstable. You get steep slopes and whatnot that can slide and give way and lead to other massive amounts of erosion.
So, John, this Coconino sandstone layer that's coming down here is actually underneath what we see here on the left.
Yeah.
So that means all that we see on the left used to be here on the right. Is that right?
Yeah. So there's a whole thick layer in here. I don't know, maybe a mile thick or so. And these layers, as the Uinta Mountains pushed up, these layers would have extended over top of the Uinta Mountains. And so what we see is just the remnant that's left. these layers, like this red layer, the Moen Kopi, used to extend up and over.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot that's been eroded away in here. And we think as the mountains were raised up, that there were a lot of processes that could remove that material fairly quickly. And so we can actually see, you know, part of a canyon out here that runs into the Green River. And the Green River goes down right into the Colorado River that goes through the Grand Canyon.
Well, I'm not the expert. To me, if I think about that amount of water all of a sudden rushing off of really soft material,
yeah,
it wouldn't take long to cut a lot of material away.
It could cut a lot of material away. And I think, you know, we often talk about a lot of these sedimentary layers being made during the flood. I think there's a lot of sedimentary layers that are going to be made after the flood as well. There's something else I want you to look at, Del. The Paleozoic and Mesozoic rocks in here at an angle. But as we look off to the north and look off into the Green River Basin, those sediments out there are flat lying. And so that means that those sediments were not laid down until these sediments were lifted up, because they're not bent or contorted.
Okay, so those forces are lifting up these rocks.
Yeah.
And all that erosion and everything is happening. That means those were laid down after all this was through.
And so as this erosion is happening, you know, where is the sediment going? These mountains get lifted up, and then the eroded sediment is going into the big lakes that are forming out there. And, you know, we see very little contortion out there. So most of the uplift, most of this uplift happened, you know, before those sediments were laid down out there.
And so the job of a geologist then would be possibly to look at the material that's being laid down out there and asking, where did that come from?
Right. Yeah, we kind of have to piece things together. So we look at the angles that are here. We look at the uplift that must have happened. We don't see that uplift out there. So we can piece together a whole series of events. And we don't need to date the rocks with radioactivity or anything like that to determine the sequence of events. We're just determining a relative sequence of events. So we know that these Paleozoic layers had to be made first, then the Mesozoic layers had to be made, the uplift happens, and then after the uplift, we get those lake sediments out there being laid down.
Are those lake sediments then laid down fairly close to the end of the flood, or?
I think they're laid down after the flood was over. So this is a mountain range that's being lifted up here. And because it's a mountain range, it's gonna be above sea level. And so this whole area would be above sea level as, you know, we get some erosion and stuff to be made. And then on the far horizon out there that we can see, those are the lake sediments that we can see off in the distance.
John, if all of those forces are lifting up the mountains at a time where all of those layers are still soft, then we wouldn't expect to see them crumble and break. Would we see them fold? Is that what we saw in the canyon?
That's right. So Andrew was studying the Tapetes in Carbon Canyon, the little side canyon of Grand Canyon. And you and I have both seen that outcrop where the Tapetes is just folded over on itself, right? And so we're gonna drive just a little ways from here into the core of the Uinta Mountains, and we'll see some of the basement rock that was lifted up from very deep, some of the Precambrian stuff. And here in Sheep Creek Geological Loop, we will see one of the limestones that's bent and deformed as this uplift took place. And that tells us that these rocks were moving around while the stuff was still soft, just shortly after it was laid down.